Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Online course on Introduction to Modern Western Art, Movements and Artists. And in this section called Modern Movements in the 20th Century, today we'll be looking at Abstract Expressionism. Abstract Expressionism or Abstract Expressionist Movement was one of the most, how to say, most remarkable art movements that took place in the second half of the 20th century. We have already seen the nature of abstract art, or particularly abstract painting, in the previous lecture. But that was not a part of a concerted movement. It was a coincidence, it was a historical simultaneity that early part of the 20th century caught the imagination of the artist in terms of the possibilities of abstract painting. But around 1945, when a few artists in America, the United States of America, began to explore abstract paintings with a very specific philosophical and conceptual framework, that came to be known or understood as a movement, not as individual efforts or individual projects. So abstract expressionism as a movement developed between the 1940s and early 1950s. Secondly, as I have already mentioned, it was an American movement, American post-World War II movement. And third, these works of American artists were a kind of competition with the Europeans who migrated to the USA as refugees during and after the war. So this is very interesting that for the first time now we see America emerging as a very important player in the history of modern Western art. Until abstract expressionism, modern Western art was by and large ruled or dominated by the European artists. So for the first time we see America coming into the scene. Now the artists here, they combine the emotional intensity and self-expression of the expressionist artists with the anti-figurative images of our avant-garde movement. So abstract painting as an idiom, as a language, was already existing even before the abstract expressionist painters came into being. But then they remodified the entire posture, the entire understanding of abstract painting, as they were driven by not just a linguistic thirst, but an expressionist thirst or a psychological quest. Now, historically speaking, abstract expressionist painting can be divided into two groups. One, action painting, and second, color-filled or hard-edged painting. Both these movements found some parallel in other European movements as well. Now, action painting is a term that was used by the first time to describe Jackson Pollock's paintings. Artists like Jackson Pollock, Franz Klein, or Willem de Kooning used their psyche as a driving force for their works, and also used real-life physical movement as a part of their process of painting. And that is perhaps possibly why the action painting term came into being. The canvas was seen as an arena, and painting was seen as an irrational, instinctive, and impulsive act. Yet, it was not merely impulse or apparently irrational instinct that generated these creations, but an extraordinary skill and command over the technique. that made these paintings change the course of modern art history. Even a quick look at three examples of abstract expressionist paintings by three distinctively famous artists like Jackson Pollock, Willem de Kooning, and Franz Klein, as we see in this picture, will give us an idea that now we are not just looking at so-called pure abstract paintings dealing with sensory impulses or films of geometry. We are looking at a human expression, some kind of psychic eruption. Now, these two photographs of Jackson Pollock painting in his studio give us a clue why action painting as a term came into being. But before that, it is to be understood that Jackson Pollock's paintings are experimental in the sense that there was a huge element of unpredictability, unknown elements in his works, because he was developing new techniques like dripping, splattering, which could not be controlled totally. So he was depending on chance, he was depending on accident to some extent. And Pollock's most famous works also have this process involved laying the canvas on the floor and walking on, and also in the wall while painting it. But this is something that has never been done by any artist before. Walking on the painting, A and B, painting, not by keeping the canvas vertical on the easel or on the wall, but laying it on the floor. So, even the orientation between the artist and the painter, between the painter and the painted object, has been completely redefined in the work of Jackson Pollock. So, the act of painting was as important as the finished product. The action should be felt by the viewers too. And this was something that was expected from the viewers. So, another important aspect with regard to abstract expressionist paintings is the scale. Usually, most of the abstract expressionist paintings, whether it is by Jackson Pollock or Willem de Kooning, Franz Klein, or in this photograph, we see the photography of the painter Mark Rothko standing right in front of his paintings. Now, most of these paintings are big in size, they are huge in scale, and thus they have an overwhelming visual impact on the viewers. This is again, I would say, a very conscious and then deliberate choice to work on canvases which are big, huge, massive in scale, and I think there is this very scale, the size, has got something to do with the very psychology or the psychological implication that these paintings might be having on us when we are looking at them. And that is why it is said that it is very difficult to experience abstract expressionist paintings unless and until you have seen them in original. One has to see them in original, one has to stand in front of them or sit in front of them, like this one. I mean, look at the scale, the relationship in terms of size between the viewers who are sitting right in front of one of the paintings by Pollock, and look at the size of the Pollock painting itself. Now, this overwhelming presence of a painting, that you are not looking at a representation or a view, or a image or a motive, but you feel like immersed in an environment created by a painting like this. And look at, once again, another photograph of Jackson Pollock, who is not only painting, but he is also, he has already entered into his own painting physically. Very soon he will be walking over his painting and then finally creating something like this. True, abstract in nature. The very visual appearance of a painting like this is completely abstract. But at the same time, there is a tremendous sense of turmoil, agitation, and a dynamic quality. And these things characterize a painting like this. When you have somebody like Franz Klein, and you see in this photograph standing in front of his extremely big, huge, massive paintings, to the extent that they don't look like paintings, I mean studio paintings at all, they look like murals, huge public wall murals. But they are not. They are paintings painted inside the studio. So when you stand in front of a Franz Klein painting, once again, what you look at is not only a visual form or symbol of expression, but you are encountering an experience and you are gradually getting engulfed by this visual experience. That was one of the reasons why most of the abstract expressionists chose to work on huge scale, a very, very big canvas. Now, this proximity, I mean, huge scale and big canvas can push you away into a distance. But in these paintings, they don't push you away. They bring you close to the form. The forms get kind of overblown into size, magnified in scale. So, a very different relationship thus takes place between the viewer and the canvas when you are standing in front of an abstract expressionist painting like this. Or this. When you look at these images on your computer monitor or in a book or on a screen, they don't look really that big or huge. So it is very important every time you look at an abstract expressionist painting printed in a book or on a monitor screen, please take note of the size of the canvas and imagine that size in your mind and try to feel the impact of that canvas only after imagining the size following the scale or the dimensions given along with the reproduction of the painting. Now, this is should be made clear that around the late 1940s and 50s, when these artists were doing abstract expressionist paintings, abstract art language, abstraction as a visual medium, has already been more or less established and accepted by the viewers as a possibility of expression. But then most of the artists did not know how to go about it, where to take it further. And this is where the confrontation of these abstract expressionist painters is very, very significant. All of them, including Mark Tobey here, a previous scholar, Willem de Kooning, or Franz Klein, Jackson Pollock, they all demonstrated to the world that abstraction can be taken to this enormous height. Abstract paintings can create a huge impact on our visual psyche. And there are a lot of painters who follow suit. Now, the second category of abstract expressionist paintings has been classified under this nomenclature called color print and hard edge, where obviously the action is not so prominent or not there at all. The paintings have been created by very, very careful application of color with a very clear, predetermined idea where to apply which color and to what extent. So there is a very strong sense of calculation in the second category of abstract paintings, as opposed to the first category, that is action painting, where calculation did not have any role to play. It was by and large instinctive, instinctual, and very positive. Now, there are two formal trends in American abstraction in the early 60s. The color print consists of large colored areas without signs or forms that the eye can catch. Color was used without any perspective, producing a sensation of impressive size, and the shades of color were diluted with the colors. So this color print and hard-edge abstract expressionist paintings, what you see is a very, very strong presence of color and, or let us say, very strong presence of color as an entity by itself. Neither it has any sense of perspective or so-called depth as we kind of perceive in our optical experience, day-to-day experience, nor these colors represent anything from the real world. Now, that is why hard-edge color-filled paintings, I mean, describe some works in which colorful atmospheres were emphasized. So, when you look at abstract expressionist paintings belonging to the second category, what you're looking at is an atmosphere created by very strong presence of colors, which do not have any references to the real world. The works have very clearly defined outlines and edges, and the precision clarify the compositions, and sometimes the edges have been diluted deliberately, as you see in Mark Rothko's paintings. The most important representatives of this movement are Mark Rothko, Barnett Newman, Ellsworth Kelly, Maurice Louis, Kenneth Nolan, besides others. Now, this is one example of color film painting by Barnett Newman. One can sense or feel a sense of depth of space, but that is not what has been intended in this painting. You're not actually supposed to measure any sense of space or depth. If you feel, it is extremely subjective. It is not a part of the intention of this painting. Now, once again, this photograph is an idea about the scale of a painting by Barnett Newman. Apparently, it is a very simple painting. Huge blue expanse with a very thin, narrow, white strip running through the painting vertically. And that is what you will be looking at. Still, you don't get bored. There is no monotony. Now, the fact that, in spite of the fact that this kind of paintings do not have many elements to offer to keep you engaged, yet there are hundreds of viewers who can keep looking at a painting like this for hours, because these paintings are contemplative by nature. These paintings are not narrative. These paintings are not descriptive. These paintings do not want to engage you with details. These paintings do not have any details. But these paintings do offer you a huge, deep, contemplative space for you to engage with. And that is what happens with the paintings by Mark Rothko, the paintings by Barnett Newman, the paintings by many other abstract expressionist painters who have worked with this color-filled expressions. But these are not expressions of direct experiences of human beings. They are expressions of a philosophical thought, of an idea, creating space for the human beings, that is viewers, to engage with, mostly philosophically. Now, the fact that these paintings not only themselves, but also they can actually help us, the viewers, to take the experience of looking at a painting beyond narrative, beyond description. And in the realm of thought, in the realm of contemplation, in the realm of deep absorbing moments, this entire credit goes to the movement called abstract expressionism. Like this. I mean, you can keep looking at hundreds of different abstract expressionist paintings, which apparently look very similar to each other, but once you make yourself familiarized with abstract expressionist paintings, you realize that despite the apparent similarity between each other, each of these paintings offer you a slightly different contemplative space. And once you are able to respond to the different tones, hues, colors as you see them, you not only contemplate philosophically or conceptually, you can also contemplate on the colors that these paintings have. Because these colors may not have any representational references, but they do have a very strong quality of absorption, like this one. And because they can absorb your mind, you're looking for a long time, that is exactly why these paintings can keep us engaged for long time, for many hours, without any descriptive details, without any narrative clues, without any referential things at all. That is the real truth of abstract expressionist paintings, and that is exactly why abstract expressionist paintings, as a movement, became immensely successful in a world which was steeped in description and narration for a long time, since the Renaissance, or even before the Renaissance, in the history of European art. Thank you.